I'm Dave. With me, hopefully always, is Matthew. Well, hey, Matthew.
Well, hello. It's going good. I'm doing well. I am Matt the Stash Sayer. This is my designated Halloween name.
And also with us, it was supposed to be a regular thing, but it hasn't worked out that way. But she's here. It's Sarah Spooky Williams. Edwards.
Williams. Nice. Oh, my God. Obviously, I need to visit a little bit more.
Yes, I agree.
You only told me that there's going to be one on. But, yes, I'm hanging here with my pumpkin.
Yep. Very nice.
Before I have a pumpkin.
You do?
I do, and it's outside, and it's turned into complete mush. And I'm waiting for the next freeze to throw it in the trash, because right now, if I pick it up, like, it's literally just going to, like, turn into a liquid and spill out all over my porch.
How long have you had this pumpkin?
Maybe a week and a half. A neighbor brought it to me.
That's a very suspicious pumpkin.
It's really spooky, I'm not going to lie, because when you touch it, it like does this like little wiggle thing. It's pretty impressive.
That's very impressive, Matthew. So, Sarah, it's been a while since we've seen you. What have you been doing?
Just hanging out, carving pumpkins, working on Apollo, doing day job, course updates, teaching, you know, pretty much keeping busy.
That's good.
Yeah.
And day job's doing well. You survived the hostile acquisition.
It was that hostile. No, we're getting merged in even a little bit more. There's new and exciting things in the future. So
nice.
Looking forward to see what happens. Yeah.
Awesome.
Great.
How is Apollo coming?
What's new? So there's nothing new yet, but I have to push the code out to GitHub. I'm hoping something this weekend is going to happen.
That sounds very optimistic.
Yeah, I know. I also thought it was like 3 weekends ago and that didn't happen either. But I've got some just updates to the main script versus some of the modules. I'm kind of waiting for Mac OS 11 to drop before I do a major update of the modules for the new operating systems. But Apple is taking their damn time releasing that. So it's a little longer than I had hoped after iOS 14, but I'm going to blame Apple on this one.
All right. Right on. Well, I want to talk for a sec about something I've been thinking about. And I want to start doing, I don't know when this is going to start. I'm hoping next month. And I've been wanting to do like coding live streams. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of, again, going back to the workshop I did a while ago with the digital forensics, the workshop was just on, hey, here's some things I've done in Python, here's how I do them in Rust, and kind of do code comparisons, but not even Rust specific. I also want to do things in Python as well. But I was like, okay, how can I do a stream where I can kind of show off all of the things I've learned over the years? Because one, I'm constantly learning new things, but two, there's a lot of things I learned that I really wish I knew when I started my, you know, doing forensics and doing scripting and tools and whatnot. And I think that if you have someone to show you some very specific things, like you could improve your coding dramatically. And I just didn't have those people to teach me those type of things, right? So I'm wanting to kind of start teaching others the things that I've learned that have made things easy. But I also want to do it in a constructive way, right? One, you want to always have an objective, but two, like contribution would be cool if, you know, check a couple check boxes at the same time, right? So Ryan Benson actually threw out some stuff on his Twitter the other day on some of his issues that would be like perfect, like first timer issues, right? And he's actually labeled them as a good first issue. Like if you're wanting to contribute to a project, these would be issues that you could contribute to that are fairly easy. That would be a great way to do a contribution to another project. I was thinking it would be really cool to do a live stream and just go through other people's projects and contribute to their projects. Especially when there's like just really easy things. Like one of them is on his parse GitHub URLs, adding parsing for IP addresses, right? Like there's already a Python module called IP addresses that allow you to basically pass in any value and it's going to parse out that IP address for you, right? Like, so go through some of these things, contribute to other people's projects. And this is why I kind of talked about this now is because you were talking about Apollo. It's like, I could do that for Apollo. Like, let's, anyways, but it's a good chance to do things like, oh, here's how you do type annotations in Python. Here's why this is extremely useful. And just good coding habits. Like, okay, now that we've added this piece, let's go ahead and add a test unit for it. And why test units are important. So this is something I've been wanting to do, along with just like more, like I would like to do some Rust live coding. The other day, I talked about it last week of, hey, I want to figure out how to create bindings for TSK. And I actually got them working this week, which is really cool. So I would like to kind of do a project with that. But I think more important than even doing that would be to just do these small little code sessions on implementing small things for other people's projects and going through like the mindset of here's how I'd go about it. Here's the things I would incorporate. Here's why I would incorporate those things. Let's build some test units. Anyways, yeah. So that's on my list of things I would like to start up in the near future.
All right. Well, now that we have the introductions out of the way, like we normally do, it's time to move over to our very haunted, spooky, Halloween-y guest, whatever you want to say. It's Halloween. I just want to work in some things. And that's Yuri Gubinov over at Belkasoft. Hey, Yuri.
Hi, how are you?
Great. So, Yuri, you and I have been talking about this happening for a while, and you said you had some amazing new stuff that you wanted to wait to show. And then we agreed on this date, and we both realized that this was the Halloween episode. So it was going to be, you know, a lot of expectation.
Yeah, well, we have a new product which I'll be presenting today. And of course, I prepared some Halloween-related stuff inside. I hope you'll appreciate that.
All right, you ready for me to switch over?
Yep.
All right, let's go.
Yeah, so let me switch my camera, not to distract you.
All right, hold on.
Can you see my screen now?
I'm going to add it back in. It had part of it cut off. So Okay. Give me 1 second, and I will fix that. There we go.
Okay, good. So, okay. Good. So let me start. Okay, hello again. That's Yuri from Belkasoft. I believe it's been some 5, maybe 6 months since my last appearance in the show. And since then, we got something new, a new product. Belkasoft is very close, not yet released, but we are very close to the release of the new product for digital forensics and incident response, which we called Belkasoft Evidence Center X, or just Belkasoft X. So in our other presentations, we are using this allegory with a rocket launch, which you see on the screen. But since today we have a Halloween episode, let me use more appropriate picture, which is on the background.
Nice.
Also, I will take a liberty to rename the show for the duration of my presentation. So let it be Belkasoft X launch on forensic launch. Well, if you object, I step back. Before I go to the topic, let me add some Halloween flower. this background I'll be using instead of our standard launch pick is a photo made by one of Belkasoft US friends. She carved our logo on a real pumpkin, which was very cute. And I see that Sarah has also something very cute on her pumpkin as well.
That Doctor Who pumpkin is kind of amazing.
Yeah, it's also pretty nice. But I like Belkasoft logo more. Sorry. Okay, now to the topic. The new product by Belkasoft is a natural evolution of its predecessor, Belkasoft Evidence Center, a digital forensic suite which offered mobile and computer forensics in a single tool, as well as memory, cloud, and remote forensics with many useful modules for incident investigations. And very briefly, here are some major benefits of the new product, including the support of both mobile and computer devices, all major operating systems, huge amount of various applications and system artifacts extracted out of the box, multiple analytical functions, decryption, including file and whole disk encryption. And there are a number of modules specifically for incident responders working in a corporate environment. On my previous appearance here, I was speaking about the remote forensics, and we also put a lot of effort to make it more user-friendly in the new product. I don't want to show lots of slides. I would prefer to show the real product in action today. And I have prepared two demonstrations, one for digital forensics part of the product functionality and another one for incident response. This way, all four letters will be respected today, DFIR. Okay, let's start with a DF demo. So let us start the Halloween edition of Belkasoft X. With a splash screen, you can see the pumpkin, of course, and some modules available in your license. And if you don't have enough time to read from the splash, the same info about the modules is shown if you click on the About button on the home screen. And let me go through those modules one by one. So those two are for computer and mobile forensics. The module set depends on the edition you have. So you can have the mobile edition or computer or all included or the corporate one. So of course I have the most complete configuration. There is a module for cloud data download. Also there are a set of modules for encryption detection, disk decryption such as BitLocker, TrueCrypt and APFS and others. And file-based decryption for a couple of hundred types of different file-based encryption. The remote acquisition and incident investigations are for corporate customers, and I will be speaking about the incident investigations module today. The Checkmate is really important for those of you who are working with iPhones and iPads. That's a famous vulnerability which allowed us to do full file system extraction from iPhones and iPads and also keychain extraction from the device. Finally, the cross-case search allows you to find intersections between your case and some other cases. For example, you might be interested that some mobile phone number used found in your case is also found on some other case. So it may give you a clue that something in common could be between those cases. Okay, let me create a new case. Give it a name. It will be forensic launch, of course. Yuri, the investigator, DF part of demo for the forensic launch. No, forensic launch. That's the proper spelling for today, right? Okay. Now case is being created. Yeah, the case is created. You can start agent data sources right away with the help of the blue big button, or you can close the window. Meanwhile, the product shows you some fake data for you to understand how your analyzed data sources would look like. Of course, when you add data sources, it will change to the real data. I have prepared a number of images, each having some interesting artifacts. Let me analyze them. First image is Haunted Hotel, a very Halloween E01 image. Once I have added an image, the product allows me to select parts to analyze. In my image, there is just one single NTFS partition, but imagine a physical Android dump. It may have dozens of partitions, so you can select only needed ones on this screen. For selected parts of an image, I can specify analysis and carving type on the next page. For example, I'd like to extract artifacts from existing files, process internal data sources, skip volume shadow copy snapshots, and restore recycle bin. For carving, I can skip it, carve everything, or carve just free space, which is only possible for NTFS file system. On the next page, I can start with a profile selection, where each profile combines set of options for different types of examinations. You can use built-in profiles, or you can edit them, or you can create yours. Then you can select artifacts to look for, say various browsers or chats grouped by operating system, such as iOS, Android, macOS, Linux, and Windows operating system. Yeah, you can see how many different chat applications we have for different systems. At the bottom here, at the left, there is a checkbox. You can opt not to extract data, which is useful when you are doing a triage. Only application profiles will be found. Finally, using the filter, you can find artifact types in the long list of supported artifacts. Say here, you can find Trillion, Tango, Hangouts, and so on. The hashes tab. You can select hash algorithms such as SHA-1, RAMD5, or SHA-256. Also, you can add a hash set to find known file matches. We support NSRL databases. I have an example of it here. It's just a textual file. Let me add it. And also, we specify the label and also type. It could be a blacklist or a whitelist. Blacklist is something bad, of course. Another one is Project Vic, which we supported in this product. So let me ingest some JSON file with the hashes and let it also be the blacklist.
Oh, nice.
Okay. So clicking next. Now it adds a hash set database. On the media tab, I can ask the product to classify pictures for different stuff like faces, guns, pornography, skin tags, and this set will be expanded in the next version. So we just added something major here. You can also do the text detection and recognition. We support 50 different languages, including hieroglyphical, such as Japanese or Chinese. And the last tab is encryption. Here, just one checkbox to search for encrypted files and volumes. Okay, everything set up, clicking next. Now you can create a new profile. Let me create a new profile called Forensic Launch, of course. I can also update existing profile if I like. Now, the data source analysis is scheduled. It's already ongoing. I can go to the tasks tab to review the progress. And this task, blue task, is a link, so I can go there. And let me add some other data sources. I have another image, which is Wicked Ether One, also very Halloweenish. For this one, I will restore snapshots. There are some interesting snapshots inside. And let me also carve it, the entire image. The same artifacts, the same hashes for media. I will detect text and let it be English. And also let me look for encryption. I don't need to update this profile, so I just click no here and go for another data source, which is a memory dump. The first memory dump I have is Dracula.mem. And once I open it, I have an option to carve it for artifacts. I can also extract processes. And since this is some Halloween image, check for malware names. I skip checking processes with VirusTotal. I can do this later from the file system explorer in the product.
I really appreciate your commitment to the theme.
Let me uncheck the hashes because it doesn't make much sense to hash the processes. Do some, well, maybe phase detection. And no search for encryption inside the memory dump. Okay, no to profile update. And now the Frankenstein, another memory dump. By the way, captured from the real laptop of real Frankenstein. So we are going to find something really, really wicked inside. Okay, and the last thing I have is a folder. And here you come on. Yep. So I go to this. Yeah, the Halloween case. Yeah, this sinister folder, of course. And I analyze it for existing files. I do this recursively. I'm going to find nested data sources. Again, hashing, and let me also look for hash sets inside this folder. Do some face detection, some skin detection, and text detection in English. Let me extract keyframes later. I'll cover the keyframes, which is interesting in this particular data source. Okay, so now I have all the data sources scheduled. You can see that some of the tasks are already completed on the tasks window, and some of the tasks have this exclamation mark here, meaning that the user input is required. This is a WeChat messenger. I don't need it for my today's presentation, so I can cancel this task. Okay, so you can see that there are a lot of tasks to do. And of course, it will take a lot of time to analyze. So let me do some Halloween magic. Okay, now we can see that all the tasks are completed. And let me go to this and see what's inside. So here there are all the artifacts extracted from all my data sources, including some interesting blockchain payments and so on. For the first presentation, for the first thing, I would like to add a filter and filter out all the data sources except this sinister folder. Here you can conveniently see how many artifacts you're going to have after the filtering. So I'm applying the filter. And at the left, you can see the amount of artifacts were decreased. Only those who came from the data source are selected. Now, since this is a Halloween case, let me look for something. We go into the search, go into the predefined search, and at the bottom of the predefined search, there are scary things. So let me select this scary things checkbox and see what the product will find for us. So clicking on OK. Well, it will take some time, of course, but we will, again, we will employ some Halloween magic. And now results are ready. Under pictures, you have the new node with a pumpkin called Scary Things. We have found 9 scary things, and all of them are pictures like Dracula, Frankenstein, the haunted hotel, and some others. You can see the hex for the selected picture, but if you go to the item text, you can see that some text were was recognized. Dracula by Bram Stoker, welcome, something, something. So, well, in non-Halloween version of Belkasoft, here you will see pictures with recognized texts. Okay, so let me continue with other artifacts. So I have already mentioned blockchain payments and wallets. What's other interesting things can be found by Belkasoft? Say it's different charts which you can review in this bubble view, or you can switch to the grid view. And of course, we scheduled encryption search, so there are different encrypted stuff. For example, those encrypted things from iPhone image, which was found inside of one of my images today. The geolocation, which can come from different sources, such as messages, pictures, taxi rides, some applications like Google Maps. And for example, here I can filter. Yeah, I have already filtered those by messages, pictures, and taxi rides, but I also have some user locations which can come from CarPlay bookmarks and so on. So for those geolocations, I can go and look them on the map. For example, if I click here, I can conveniently see the coordinate, and also I can see what was the type of item, what was the profile, the data source, and description, if any. And of course, I can magnify to make this cluster split into separate geolocation items. Okay, what else is here? Hash sets. Remember, I scheduled some hash set search. Here, just one hash match was found. Some snowboard video. Don't know what's bad with it, but it was it had this hash set match. So I can go from that match to the file system to review where this video was stored. I can see all this NTFS times. I can see the MD5 and SH1. And of course, I can go to the hex viewer and see what's inside this file. Going back to artifacts, well, what's what else is interesting in my case? Some heart rate extracted from different MiFit or Fitbit fitness trackers. I can see different jump lists from system files, emails, malware. For malware, I will go through malware a little bit later on my presentation. Some passwords, some of them were extracted from iTunes backup, which is also a new feature for Belkasoft. Some pictures, which I have already shown, sleep, again, from fitness trackers. System files, which we'll cover a little bit more in my incident response part of the demonstration. Taxi rides, well, even translations, you can see what terms the user was trying to translate using Google Translate app. Voicemails, Wi-Fi connections, Wi-Fi configurations, wireless configurations, and so on. Let me also show you something interesting. Let me go to the structure, which is a little bit more detailed with regards to where the profile has been taken from. And here I can see the driver, which is actually it's a CarPlay. So if I go to the geolocation data, which was extracted from this particular application, I can review it in SQLite database, a SQLite database viewer. And that's one of the interesting features here we have is showing the record type and also sorting and filtering by these record types. So you can see that here I have some free list items, I have right ahead log items, and somewhere at the bottom only I have regular items. So if you can see the bottom of my screen, out of 800 items, I have 600 journal records and 32 deleted records. So if I only see on the regular items, I would see just 100 something, 130 probably items,
very nice.
Which is of course not good in a forensic investigation. But again, all these items are automatically recovered, so you don't have to know about those types of records. All of them are merged here, but you will have this is deleted column, and also for each record you will be able to see from where it was originated. And when you click here at the top, at the bottom in the mini SQLite viewer, you can see a particular record from where this item has been originated. And that's one of the most convenient things. For every out-of-the-box extracted item, you can see the item text, the hex, the original hex from the raw bytes. You can also see the SQLite, if it was stored in SQLite. If it was a plist, you will see the plist. If it was a registry, you are going to see the registry viewer. Okay, yeah. Now, yeah, hash sets I have shown. The videos, one of the interesting videos, one of the interesting features with videos is this one. So here I have some 150 videos. And if I go to the table view, there is a column, new column called video streams. Here you can see some videos with one video streams and zero video streams, which are probably links to videos without actual content. However, if I click here on the funnel icon to filter, there is a new filter called videos with multiple video streams. Let me explain why it's important, but first let me apply. And I have two video streams here, two videos with more than one video stream. Let me click on one of them. It's output MKV. Oh, no, that's not the correct one, the input. Yeah, this one is a Belkasoft promo video, but if I go to the video track, I can see two video tracks. Let me switch to another one. And you can see completely different picture here, but the same music, of course. I can go to audio track, change it to the second audio track. I don't think you hear that, but penguins are screaming.
Hey, we don't hear it. We don't believe you.
So what happens is that in the same video file, you can have two videos. And of course, for audio tracks, it's pretty natural. You can have a translation of two different languages, even several translations for the same language, right? But having multiple video streams, it's kind of weird. And this is something what bad guys use to hide some illegal content. So the good feature here is that you can quickly find those two bad videos out of thousands which you can find on a regular device. Moreover, if you go to the keyframes, you can extract keyframes from videos, and you can pay attention that here you can see this Belkasoft launch picture. And here you can see those penguins. And for your convenience, the name contains a number of the streams. So that's a stream 00, and this one, the stream 02. So those are numbers of streams inside the video. And of course, you can right-click on the video. Well, you have to check them first. And then you can right-click and analyze, say, for pornography or for guns or for faces, or whatever we can do for still images. We can also do, of course, for keyframes. Well, that's pretty convenient new feature. Okay, let me go to the file system now and show you something interesting about the low-level forensics with Belkasoft. Well, of course, you can review any file in the hex viewer. You can see the properties, such as time and was it deleted or not. You can, for folders, you can see which folders are deleted and were recovered. The convenient feature is to be able to review all the snapshots and they are shown at the same level as the actual. So this is the actual state of the hard drive, and these are snapshots. So you can expand the snapshot and see that they might be different with the current state of the hard drive, so you can see the difference. You can also see the difference in between snapshots, actually. So here you can see that pictures for PhotoDNAs 7, and here they have just 5. So I click here.
You're actually deduping between the volume shadow copies. That's excellent.
Yeah. So here everything ends with 8 to 7, and here we have 8 to 8. So we double click and we see the suspect inside the picture viewer. So this picture has been deleted in between those two snapshots, and it's a very handy to be able to see this difference and then to see what was deleted. Okay, if remember, I have added a number of sinister memory dumps. So one of them, that's Dracula. First of all, you can see that we didn't ask you for the profile of operating system. We detected it automatically. So clicking here on this memory dump, I can see all the processes here, and I can see things like the offset, the files, well, it's not file, it's process size. And I can see that sometimes you can even recover dead processes. Also, if I go to another memory dump, which was this Frankenstein, remember I was asking the product to find the malware names. So it's here under is the process name suspicious. And of course it's a Halloween image. It's very, very sinister. So every process names, including SVC host, is suspicious. Well, that's kind of a joke, of course, for the Halloween presentation, but in real life, this process will be detected as suspicious because it pretends to be a system one. WinLogOn is a proper name for the system process, but this one is WinLogN. Apart from that, you can see that there is some processes marked with a malware name. So some, I uploaded those memory processes to VirusTotal, and it gave me some results. It is smart screen is WinExploit CVE something something. And at the right, you have the VirusTotal link, which you can use to check why this or that process or file was considered to be harmful. Okay, that's about the malware. What else we have here? Well, connection graph. Connection graph shows you all the people in your case. So I have filtered it. Let me reset some filters. So you can click on a person to see its properties. You can click on the link to see all the communications they have. You can also right click and create a report right from here. And it will open you the PDF. And this PDF will include this picture and the table of actual conversations, emails, whatever is inside. I was speaking about the analysis for some 20 minutes already, but there is not only analysis. We also have the triage, and we also have acquisition part, so we can acquire some hard drives. You can acquire some cloud data like Google Cloud or iCloud. And of course, we have Android and some Apple acquisition. And with Apple acquisition, we made some good progress last year. So we know we were one of the first companies to support that Checkmate, which is carved on the Sarah's pumpkin. So I believe she will be speaking about this today. I have in my previous, I think it was May when I was speaking about Checkmate in Forensic Lunch. Back then it was Forensic Lunch, right? So I will not be speaking about it today, but just to let me switch to the presentation. And here, there are some updates on IaaS Forensics we have in the new product. So first of all, support for Checkmate for iOS 14. Some models. If you're interested, go to belkasoft.com/checkmate to see which ones. For agent-based acquisition, which we used to have in the older product, in the new product, we supported keychain extraction, which is pretty important. And also we supported keychain extraction for iTunes backup. And based on keychain, you can do different decryptions. For example, we used to have signal decryption, but now we also added Vicker decryption using the keychain. And of course, there are a number of important artifacts and databases we support in the new product, like KnowledgeC, health application, and I don't even mention Facebook, WhatsApp, Telegram, and other applications which we used to have before, but of course we are updating with each release. Okay, that was the digital forensic part of my demo. Now let me address a part of our audience who are on the corporate side. For the incident response demo, I would like to show you, because it's Halloween today, I would like to show it in the dark theme to also satisfy all saints. So it will require the relaunch of the product. So maybe if there are any questions meanwhile, I can answer, or we just wait a little bit before the product opens.
I think I really like my question to you is, you know, I think one of the big things that was amazing that you showed last time was your ability to do a remote mobile acquisition. And you had the agent running. Have you made any changes or updates to that since?
Well, we mostly spend a lot of time to make it much more user-friendly. So the previous product, it has a lot of features around those remote acquisition. But it was not very friendly with regards of tuning the options. And you know, speaking about remote acquisition, there are multiple network configurations, things like routers, port forwarding, and so on. So what we made in the new release is we tried to make it as easy as possible. So not many improvements in the acquisition itself, but many improvements in the usability of it. And the whole product, the whole new product is very much about the usability. So we spend a lot of time testing how handy it is going to be. Okay, so now, meanwhile, the case is loaded. And this is interesting case. This is a real virtual machine infected with one of the malware. We made it kind of a honeypot, so it eventually was infected. And let me try to trace what happened inside this machine. So first of all, there is an incident investigations tab, which is one of your main tools if you're doing incident response. Here, all the items are grouped by several nodes. Persistence, which shows how the malicious code persists on your system using different techniques. Execution proves the fact that some executable file was run. System event logs. Of course, the system event log for Windows is huge, but there are some event types which you immediately try to investigate when you are doing incident response. So we combined those in a single view and also did some pre-processing for you to easier review those events. And finally, recent files and downloaded files, which can give you a clue about the attack vector, how the attack started. So that's a pretty interesting case. You know, some attackers use WMI, which is Windows Management Instrumentation. So they use WMI event subscription to obtain persistence on the target host. And many exploitations framework, for example, PowerShell, Empire, and CoAdic allow to achieve it automatically. So it becomes more and more common. We added automatic detection of WMI subscription in Belkasoft. It's a kind of unique feature. And if you see here, there are two WMI event subscription. One is perfectly good, but the other one is pretty suspicious. So you can review its property at the right or at the center in the item text. So what we can see is that this is something what is run when the system starts. At the computer startup, the operating system will run MSHTA with this path. So this is some HTML application. So your first idea is it can contain JavaScript, right? So, and of course it will contain, as we will see very soon. So I let me bookmark it. You can see this bookmark item is appeared here. Now, it was the argument was C program data something TRG something. So let me now go to the file system and locate this file. Okay, here it is, TRG. So I can review it in a full size hex viewer. Let me adjust window a bit. What I can see that, well, yeah, it's indeed some textual file, so it doesn't make much sense to review in the hex viewer. And I go to my favorite viewer, which is, I copied as a hex, but I should copy as text, right? Okay, now it's better. So there are a lot of interesting stuff happening in this JavaScript, but what I immediately attracts my eye is the IP address, right? So should we check this IP address? Yes, we should. And also we should look for this file probably. So what else I can see from here? So it's being downloaded, this FQ, maybe something is being downloaded from this host. It's stored under temporary folder, then it starts, and then it's being deleted. So what does it mean? That this file is not stored in the memory. So upon the system startup, WMI will run this HTA file, which will download this WSF file, execute it, and delete. So it will only be, it will only persist in memory. There will be no traces on a hard drive, unless you try to recover deleted files, right? So that's very interesting. Okay, going back. And now let me do some searches. Of course, I did these searches before. So I did a search by the IP address and I have found some 23 hits. Most of them are from a browser. From the search, I can right click and go to the original item. And I will see a lot of links like that. Talking to this 77 host, and it was made with Internet Explorer 10, maybe Edge. So we found, since some malware is uploaded using HTML application, so it goes through a browser, so we can see the history of the communication with the command server with this 77 IP address. Okay, so by the moment, we know that we have a server which loads some bad stuff in our network through WMI event subscription. So what else? Let me go back to the incident investigations. If I go to this system event log, there is a separate node called 7045, and 7045 here stands for an installation of a service. So we can look which services are installed, nothing too suspicious. But you know that if malware is involved, if something was recently installed, such as a service, If I sort by the time, installation time, I see the service which looks pretty suspicious. The name doesn't look like Microsoft Trusted something, right? So when I click on it, I can see that, again, that's a bitsadmin, which downloads the same FQB file from the same 77 host, right? So malware tries to use multiple persistence mechanisms in order to survive. So this is one additional way to survive. And this time the attackers tried to escalate privileges using this service. If I go to the schedule tasks, well, again, nothing too special here. But if you look here, well, actually, I can just do the filter. And I can see this quadic schedule tasks. And again, it runs MSHTA. So that's something what will also be started at the Windows startup. And also remember the time of installation of the scheduled tasks. It is 26th of October, right?
You still there? Yuri?
Well, that's not good.
It's like a cliffhanger.
Maybe he can use that little wiggle function and make him reappear. Come on, some Halloween magic, Yuri. I know you can do it.
Come on, Yuri. Resurrect. Resurrect.
Resurrect. That's the wires for today.
Well, you know, zombies. They come back from the dead.
I'm really impressed with the amount of effort he's taken to put all Halloween yes. stuff in.
Because I appreciate that too.
I think we all know how long it takes to put stuff like this together. And the fact that it was all Halloween themed, like this took thought.
I'm actually giving a presentation a little bit later on this evening. And yeah, mine's all Halloween themed.
Oh,
I did the same thing.
He dropped. All right. You're dropped.
Sports.
Hey, he's back.
The zombie's back.
Yuri.
Oh, yeah. When did I disappear?
You disappeared right when you were showing the
October 26th timestamp.
Yeah, the October 26th timestamp.
When I was at the. October 26th.
Yes.
Yep.
Okay. So yeah, good. So we were here in the schedule task.
You need to share your screen again, Yuri.
I'm not sharing. Okay, give me a second. Enter screen and can you see me now?
And yes, it's coming up.
Okay, let me start from this date. So just here remember 26th of October. We will need it in the next few seconds. So we know some persistence used for this malware. And let's try to imagine what else attackers can do once they got a compromised account. So they definitely do not want their account to be noted and blocked. And the solution they might have used is to create a new account. Now, let me go back to the old good artifacts, forensic artifacts, right? So I go to here, to the Windows username and SID list, try to see something wrong. Well, it's hard to say that something was wrong. Well, the last write time doesn't mean the account creation, right? Because it's extracted from the registry file. And the last write time is SSHD server administrator. So I'm not sure this is suspicious. So let me now go back to the file system. So Internet Explorer user is old. Public user is very old. SSHD is beginning of 2000. 18. The Taylor user, it's actually our user who was infected, created 18th of August. But when I click on the support, this user was created on 26th of October. So that's really suspicious. Probably this was indeed the user which was created by the malicious code. let's go back to old good forensic artifacts. Now I'm using the structure because it will give me needed flexibility. Now I can see only artifacts extracted for this support user, not for everyone. So here in Explorer programs, remote desktop. That's suspicious. And also, if I go to the recently accessed documents, you can see some Word documents with, well, if you ever did the customer support, if you have the support something, support at belkasoft.com or support at Forensic Lunch, for example, you know that every day you are going to receive emails with such receipts. And of course, you shouldn't open them. All of them are infected. Probably this is one of additional mechanisms to persist in the system. So I wouldn't trust names of documents like that. So that's what this support user was opening recently. Okay, let me go back to the incident investigations. Remember the support account was using the remote desktop connections, and we can see he made this at least three times. And of course, it was speaking to a 77 host, probably transferring something like documents or stolen passwords or whatever they were trying to steal. Well, this was a virtual machine, nothing to steal, but of course they were trying to contact the command and control center to send some important information. Nice. Okay, last thing I would like to show, if you go to the timeline, well, here you can do some filtering for dates in October last year. And you can filter some interesting event types. What we can be interested in, download finished and download started. Last logged in, probably. Login failed, also very suspicious if someone tries to brute force your account. And, well, USB, well, probably that's it. So I apply, not many interesting information found, but if you pay attention to the top of my list, it's application form.exe. And interesting enough, it was opened much prior to the infection. So you also know this application stuff. You get an email saying you won $1 million, so you just have to click on this application form and fill it, and then a truck will come to your house with $1 million or $1 billion. But of course, you won't get anything except of malware script executed on your machine. So this could be initial attack vector on your machine. So the timeline is very handy to trying to understand how the attack was developed. Okay, so let me go back to my slides. So that's actually it for my demonstrations. And just a summary, we are launching a new product, DF and IR product called Belkasoft Evidence Center X, or I actually name it Belkasoft X or just Belk X. I didn't speak about money, but that's unique occasion that we made it less expensive than previous product. We repackaged it, and for the same features, you are going to pay less than in the previous product. So that's pretty unique. And you can try it right now at belkasoft.com/trial. Just pay attention, you will get two links. The first link for the older product, just because many customers would like to stick to the previous design, previous workflow. And the second one is the link which you should use in order to try the new product. So pay attention to that. All right. Okay, so I know, Dave, you could be unhappy that I renamed your show to the Forensic Launch. So to stay friends, I take a step of goodwill and rename Belkasoft product launch to Belkasoft product launch. Let me conclude my hello in presentation here.
Very nice, Yuri.
Yeah. If I have any questions, I can show myself.
Yeah. So we have a couple minutes left. And for those of you who are watching live, do you have questions for Yuri? I mean, Yuri, I think we were all commenting how much we admire your commitment to the Halloween theme. but no, I mean, it looks great. I'm gonna give it a shot for sure. And the idea that you lowered the price of it, I think, is boggling my mind a little bit.
Well, you know, we repackaged it, so I hope that we will not lose money. But yes, we deliberately try to stay in the same price category.
So are you going to keep both tools out there, or are you basically replacing one with another?
Well, we will be replacing. Good question. Yeah, we will be replacing, but it will depend on customers. Maybe some of them will try to you know, some of them get used to it for many years.
Yeah.
So we will be supporting it for some time, but the upgrade is free, so we don't charge anything. So if you are happy with the older one, stay with it. We believe in the new products. So of course we ask customers to go to them, and this is completely free.
Wow.
Nice.
Okay. Well, other vendors, there you go. Yuri has thrown down the gauntlet.
That's not a Halloween joke.
I guess it's only spooky to your competition. Well, Yuri, thanks so much for coming on. Really appreciate it. Really liked what you had to show. And everyone who watched live, thanks for tuning in. I think we had more talk about the fact that, you know, they like to use your tool on their Day 6 Sans class than anything else. But this is great stuff. And again, for those of you who are wondering, you know, can you come on and talk about what you're working on? Absolutely. Just give us a reach and we'll see whether or not it's a good fit. And we have lots of guests we're lining up for the rest, and I'll be putting out a broadcast schedule soon. But other than that, enjoy your Halloween. I hope you guys have lots of fun and stay safe. See you next time.